Bureau as well as we are live on Facebook. So if you do not wish to be seen, please switch off your video and keep it off. Later in the session, we will be taking a group photograph. That's a screenshot of the screen. So we will request all those who don't mind being seen to switch on their video, but that'll be at the end. For now, I just want to welcome everyone. And I know COVID-19 has been extremely hard on many people, and therefore the US Consulate General of Mumbai wanted to focus on some of these sessions, which will help us adjust, but also help us, upskill ourselves, build our capacity and resilience, as well as implement better policies and learn from each other. So today, I'm very pleased to have with us members of the US Consulate General of Mumbai. And I'd like to thank Sabina, Sita, and the entire team for giving us this opportunity. As you know, Dosti House, which is the American Library, is a very vibrant space. And normally we would host these events in person there. Unfortunately, everything has moved online, and you must check their page, the Facebook page out, because this is just one of the many sessions that Dosti House and the American Library is hosting. So what we're going to do today is have a panel discussion. Before that, we have Alexander Hunt, who's the Vice Consul, who will say a few words, followed by a panel discussion with very eminent speakers. I will introduce them in a bit. And then we will have breakout sessions where in smaller groups, you can share with us your best practices and things that have worked very well for you during this time. And hopefully we'll be able to curate a list of all these best practices. And my colleague Supreet K. Singh will wrap up the session at the very end. So I'm going to end the poll. And I'm going to invite Supreet to read out the results.
Supreet? It's still saying feedback. It's still in process. So another 10 seconds. So Elsa, there's some technical glitch because it's showing me the next poll.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not showing me the earlier one.
Tanya, is it possible for you to read it?
Just give me a minute, Elsa. I'll just... Yes, so... 1 second. No, it's picked up the second poll, Elsa.
Yeah. That's the one.
No, it's not giving me the option. Sorry.
Okay. We'll share the results a little later if, we'll pick it up from the back end. So without further ado, I want to introduce Alexander. Alexander Hunt is the Vice Consul at the US Consulate of Mumbai. He joined the consular section in January 2020 after completing his first assignment in Quito, Ecuador. And he joined the Foreign Service in 2016 after spending 5 years overseas, mainly in India, where he managed an international exchange program, consulted for the UNESCO, and worked as a marketing strategist for a think tank. He also taught world languages to foreign diplomats serving in Delhi. So welcome, Alexander. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. On behalf of the consulate, I want to thank you all for joining us today for this program on work from home best practices. We also really want to express our gratitude to our partner, Red Dot Foundation, and to our panelists today for joining us. As we all know, early this year, the pandemic struck hard and fast, and in many ways, the world was completely unprepared for it. And life has just been turned upside down for all of us since. We face many challenges on many multiple fronts, among them maintaining social distancing while working from home. So it's not an easy task to achieve work-life balance in these unprecedented times. Most of us are struggling to keep our work lives and personal lives separate. It's commonplace now to check our work email at all hours, take business calls at the dinner table, and work on our laptops in the middle of the night. So with this work behavior now the norm, burnout has become a real concern. And so this change in work-life balance has actually been linked to reduced physical and psychological well-being. It has lowered productivity and increased stress-related ailments. So now we're all wondering how to cope. This balancing act isn't easy, but there are some techniques that we can consider to really streamline our new teleworking reality. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from the speakers today who can shed some light on some best practices to deal with the situations that we're currently facing. Before we get started, I do want to share some information on our American space in Mumbai that was mentioned. Dosti House is really the place to learn, collaborate, and engage on important issues that are important to the United States and the India relationship. We have a lot of print and online resources which members can use for research and reading. There's even a program now to have those couriered to you. And at Dosti House, we conduct both in-person and virtual programs on areas such as women's empowerment, STEM education, gender issues, human rights, Education USA, and English language programs. So this program today is one such initiative. And so we just welcome you to visit Dosti House once things stabilize and we reopen our doors. But in the meantime, please feel free to use our resources virtually. So thank you again for being here, and I'm really looking forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Alexander. And it's our pleasure to partner with you. We've always found it to be a very supportive environment. Thank you. So without further ado, I want to introduce my guest for this evening. We have Dr. Jasmine Gogia. She's the head of CSR Sustainability and Occupational Health at the Suzlon Foundation. She's also the chairperson of the Prevention of Sexual Harassment at the Workplace Committee and the Community Grievance Redressal Committee within the Suzlon Group. She's a medical doctor by training and has had over 27 years of experience in rural development and public health. So welcome, Jasmine. We have Mena Sheikh, who's the former head of HR for India and SAARC at Godrej Consumer Products Limited. And prior to that, she had 13 years of varied experience with Procter & Gamble in different roles, business partnering, recruitment, learning, compensation, OD. And she's now joining a startup, and I'll let her tell you more about it later. So welcome, Menas. And then we have Shanta Valluri Gandhi. She's the head of human resources, CSR, and internal branding at RBL Bank. She brings with her over 30 years of experience in the financial services sector, spanning various roles and functions, including business and HR and CSR. And she is part of the core transformational team that set up RBL Bank. Welcome, Shanta. And finally, we have Mr. Suman Ghosh, who heads HR for Bajaj Electricals Limited, a 3,000 employee, multi-plant, multi-geography organization based out of Mumbai. He joined Bajaj Electricals in 2011 and has handled multiple portfolios in HR, including HR business partnering, compensation and benefits, and at present, the entire gamut of HR. And prior to that, he worked with Tata Communications Limited for more than 13 years. So welcome everyone, good evening. And how have y'all been coping with COVID-19? Let's start with Jasmine.
Thank you, Elsa. It has been a pleasure to be here to share our experiences. As far as COVID-19 is concerned, I think we all are struggling with it. But I have always been a very positive person, and I always look at the bright side of stuff. And I felt that this was a real good time to reflect and to put our strategies in place for what's to come. So the lockdown period in particular, I did a lot of preparation because we are working in the wind energy sector, which is essential services and has to be open. The sites have to be open throughout. Even during the lockdown period, the site engineers had to go on the sites to do the work. So therefore, it was a time for me personally to reflect, but also to prepare for what's ahead, because when the lockdown period would be over, there would be a lot of risk to those people at the site who are looking after the wind turbines. So it has been mixed, but I'm very positive about the outcomes of this particular difficult period.
Thank you, Jasmine. Menas, how about you?
So firstly, thank you for this opportunity. Can you hear me clearly, Elsa?
Yes.
Okay. I think there's a saying that goes, and I think it's Churchill who said this. He said, never let a crisis go to waste. And I think this has been one of that crisis, which I think both as individuals and organizations, we've learned immensely from. I think if I had to give you a sense of what the last few months have been like, I think I've discovered what it looks like to have an entire organization driven by a collective purpose. Because Godrej was in the essential commodities, especially something as essential as soaps, right? So how can that drive factories, salesmen, people in the offices? Second, I think the role that we as HR play to be able to react to these new realities of virtual working, of people figuring out and juggling their various schedules without support system in most cases. And I think lastly, it's been a personal journey too, which is of staying at home and still managing work 24/7 along with my son and discovering a bit more about him and myself, I think. So yeah, it's been interesting to say the least.
Great. So thank you and congratulations on your new assignment.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Shanta, how are you doing?
I'm great, Elsa. Always a pleasure. You know, today the session was on work from home. So I had to work from home. Yeah. Otherwise, you know, it wouldn't have looked proper. It would have been a very improper beginning. So therefore, I'm working from home today. But let me be honest that we are an essential service. And first and foremost, thank you for this opportunity. And Alexander, thank you for telling us a little bit of dosti. Because I think, you know, it makes a lot of sense whether virtual or physical, because certain things that you lead will be very useful for us as a company. And I'm very happy to have heard what you said this just now, just before the other two speakers. It's interesting to say that, you know, we've been going to office since March. So for us, work from home is probably when we are, you know, doing a seminar like this. But we've always had about 50% of our employees working from home and 50% coming into office. The times, fortunately, all these webinars are happening 6 months into COVID. Had you asked me this question in the month of April, I would have been very anxious. Where I sit today and I look back and reflect, I think this is something that's happened first time in our lifetimes and so also our parents. So there's been no guidance. And you know, there's this famous quote of ignorance is bliss. I think we use that very effectively. Strongly believe that this is a combination of life and livelihood. And that's what we've been focusing on, that yes, life is important, but money is too. You know, ultimately you need to get back to earning enough to run a home. And when you run a home, you also run a complete society, because you pay for your servants, you pay for your drivers, you know, even going to work, you need a driver and he gets paid and that's how his home runs. I think we focused on all of these elements and then worked out our strategy as to what is the right way, because I had HR and CSR. So there is an underprivileged community also who works for us, both at work, at home, and otherwise. So we looked at a holistic program as to how we want to handle it. On a personal level, I work 4 days, 3 to 4 days a week from office and about a day from home. And I would like to share my experiences for sure, because I'd probably be a little different, just not on work from home, but also work from office and how as a company we've tried to get a balance as an essential service, you can't do this with a doctor or a nurse today. So we are cognizant of the fact that if you were termed as an essential service, you drive from the top. And that's why I'll be happy to share as we go along in the panel. But it's great to see these wonderful panelists. You know, and thanks, Elsa, for putting this through, yeah, because it's always a pleasure to get best practices.
Thanks, Shanta. Yeah, I know it was very difficult. And honestly, you know, now 7 months into it, it feels like we've survived.
Yeah.
But this is only the beginning. You know, if you talk to different groups of people, they're saying anything from 1 year to 2 years to maybe 6 months. So we are operating in an ambiguous environment. And like you said, there was no guidance. There was nothing to benchmark against. So we were all working in, you know, as per our own judgment with very little information. So, yeah, so, and that's one of the reasons why I think it's important to compile in a way some of these best practices and also learn how everybody, big organizations, small organizations, SMEs, and everyone has been coping. And if we haven't instituted that, maybe there's a way to do that. So thank you. And Suman, what has been your experience?
Hi, Elsa. Thank you for having me here. Thanks, Red Dot Foundation and U.S. Consulate General. And good evening to fellow panelists as well as all the viewers out here. All of you have already mentioned that this kind of a situation that we have never faced before, it's a very unprecedented situation that we have out here. In our lifetime, we have never seen this kind of a situation out here. So as an organization, if you, if I have to tell you, we have learned a lot. We have learned a lot about our strengths, about our weaknesses, while we are trying to navigate through the situation. Our leadership has been tested each and every day, because each and every day has been, something new is coming up. Either some new place is getting under lockdown or something some state going under lockdown or new places opening up with COVID cases. So we had to, juggle through a lot of uncertainties. But we're happy that, we have been able to sail through. And looking at the business today, so I think we have already come up to the last year's level. Yes, there are some challenges in terms of supply chain and manpower movement or logistics, etc. But we hope that we are going to overcome that also. On a personal front, sitting at home and working from home for 7 long months, it's never had happened in my career. So yes, I did get a lot of time for spending with the family, with my kids, etc. But I think now it's becoming too much. So it's getting somewhat fatigued. It's better to get back to work now.
Yeah, you're itching to go back, right? Like yeah. Yesterday was my first social function in 7 months at the US consulate. It was in a hotel. It was socially distanced, in a big ballroom for 400 people, only 50 people were there. We all wore masks, but it was nice to meet people for the first time, So that's social. We are all social creatures and we want and we crave that interaction, right? And we are trying to replicate all this online through technology, which is not our nature otherwise. Anyway, so maybe begin with you again, Suman. What are the three best practices that you would say that as head of HR you implemented in your organization?
Okay, as I was mentioning that, this situation has been something which we have never faced as an organization. And to be very honest with you, although work from home as a concept, has not been talked about too much in Bajaj Electricals. The reason being, we have primarily two businesses. One is a B2C business and the other one is a B2B business. While B2C business has got a large sales force who are supposed to work from, in the field, meeting distributors, dealers, retailers, etc. And but the B2B business, which is primarily our projects business, and people have to work in the remote sites, etc. So the learning piece has been a challenge for us as an organization, because you know, people, getting people from the field and from the remote sites to come to classroom sessions, etc., has been a big challenge for us. So this gave a big opportunity for us to actually scale it up a lot. Because in the initial couple of months, when everything was completely under lockdown, people had no option but to sit at home, and those who had a computer and some kind of internet connection, we could really, utilize that time and opportunity for upskilling them. There were a lot of, functional training programs that we had, product trainings, etc. So I think that's one aspect of that good thing that we could do. Yes, that also helped us, our people to, adopt technology as a part of their life. So that also got imbibed in them. So going forward, we hope that we will be able to, encash that a lot more. The second best practice, I don't know if it's a best practice or not, but that's something which we felt that's something which is needed for our people. So looking at a situation that, people were at home, the families were at home, and they are still at home, in fact. Over the weekends, people, used to go to go out to malls or to watch some movie with the families. So all those things got stopped. So essentially, people were feeling frustrated. So what we did is, for our employees and their families, we rolled out a hell lot of, employee engagement activities over the weekends. And it was not only meant for the employees, but also for their family members, but they also participated. And that's how, we kept them engaged. And for our customers also, we rolled out a couple of initiatives, rolling out a app which would only talk about the recipes, different recipes that you would have being a consumer company. So we rolled out that. So this has got nothing to do with our products, etc., but just our the recipes where people can actually learn what kind of recipes that they want to cook. The third aspect which I would like to talk about is the employee care that we did. Bajaj Electricals is always known for a very caring organization and a caring employer. And what we saw that during this time, there people were undergoing a lot of work stress. So the line between the personal life and a work life had actually got blurred. We are all working for almost 12 hours, 14 hours a day. And then somebody mentioned that while eating also we are taking calls, etc. So it was at some point in time it was becoming too much for our employees, and we got a feel of that, and that's how we issued a general broad guideline that we should end the day at best by 7 or 7:30 in the evening. We should try to spare the weekends for any meetings or any reviews not to happen at the time. And also give enough time for lunch break or some time to relax, etc. Although we expected people to be online, but then still we started to give them some kind of a broad guidelines to work on. So that was done to manage the work stress. As far as the health stress is concerned, so people were also our employees also were undergoing health stress because of the concern that they have, because as I said, we have a large sales force. We started going out into the market. The project site people, they started going out to the project site. So they were exposed to this corona thing. So besides our medical cover that we have for all employees in general, we also rolled out another additional corona cover for our employees where they can, they're covered from the company side. And additionally, they were also allowed to cover their immediate family members, their parents, etc. So that was trying to give them some kind of a solace and some kind of a support that yes, we are there as an organization to support you. And there have been many instances where employees were got admitted to the hospital and suddenly they were out of cash, etc. So we jumped into those kind of situations and tried to help them out. Yeah. Home stress, yes. There is a home stress also. Initially, it started with we all feeling that yes, it's good to be at home, be part of family, spend time with the family, watch Netflix or maybe go through some books, etc. But over a period of time, gradually the saturation started seeping in, and we started feeling that, you know, we are missing the office, missing the energy, missing our colleagues, you know. And I think, like, you know, right now the situation is where we are. We started getting, you know, a little fatigued and bored. So I really don't know what to do on that front. But yeah, we are trying to give as much support for through all these, you know, initiatives that we could think of. Yeah, that's.
I think during this time, a lot of people are worried about the medical aspect, you know, the bills. How, if you did get corona and you went to hospital, how were you going to manage? So I love the fact that you all did that corona insurance. And for some of those questions that you have, maybe the other panelists might also have some answers. So thank you for sharing with us. What about Shanta? You know, because the bank employees are also a mix of frontline and not frontline employees. So what were your three best practices?
So, you know, when you ask these straight questions, you have to think whether they were 3 or 30. You know, because it was a distraught moment. And, you know, when you come back to reality, it's far easier today to tell you what we did and what we did well and what we could have done better. So I think the month of April was about March, actually March 23rd, I think this whole thing happened. And, you know, if you look at banking, the books close on March end. So there is a crisis management because your books have to close. So the first partner that I thought was most important was my technology partner. You know, banking also is a trust business. So we have to be very careful about our cybersecurity, our other aspects, which are so critical. So I think technology as an enabler was our first activity that we started. So what did we do? We gave access to every employee. See, when you have 7,500 employees and about 40% of them are frontline salespeople, they necessarily don't have laptops. And it's not easy to procure laptops overnight because, you know, every seller is having the same demand. So I think what we actually did was, which we did very well in the first 10 days of this, and which was actually end of March to early April, was ensuring that all the laptops were laptops, desktops, bring your own laptop or bring your own desktop. Everything was security was completely managed. Because we are talking about customers' money here. So I think that was a very big investment that we did and we got the act together. And I must compliment my IT teams along with the HR teams who did a phenomenal job to make sure this was seamlessly delivered. I think that was our first call to action. Our second call to action was to ensure that our HR teams call every employee personally to find out if there are any challenges that they are facing today, because COVID had already come into the country. So what could we do? Because COVID became a bad word, right? Everybody was so scared, not knowing whether there was a treatment or anything. So Corona insurance was actually something which was added on by the insurance companies. Let me also tell you, because we got this as a benefit, I used that as a channel to inform all my employees that we cover Corona. Okay, so that people know that they don't have to get frantic about it. I think that was an immediate action that we took for employees who were sitting away from main space where they were operating from. The third bunch, so there has always been this combination of life and livelihood. Our entire strategy is spanned around life and livelihood. The third thing was that we had to get some employees to work. It doesn't matter whether you're a branch employee or you're a central office employee. So we mapped all the employees across the country and said who is absolutely critical and important to come into main space, which is offices other than branches. Branches, we moved overnight to a roster system. So we could maintain the social distancing. We got our administrative offices to actually put caution stickers on seats you can't sit on because, you know, there was a mandate to keep a 6-foot distance. Based on that, we arrived at the number of people who can come to office on a day-to-day basis. If so many people are going to come to office, how do we get them to office? You know, so we had to get our buses organized for our employees. You know, in those days, no Uber, no Ola, nobody was flying. So getting a bus at a price cost, which was ridiculous, in addition to thermal scanners, sanitizers, your oximeters, you know, every floor had to be provided that. The saddest part is when you are in a crisis, everybody increases their rates and prices. You know, so I think as a community, we need to understand that when there is a need, you don't try to make an extra buck. You get together, you collaborate. So what we did is the banking HR heads decided to collaborate. So we activated a group which was already there, and we became extremely active as people who wanted to manage crisis together. And we actually started negotiating rates which were at a larger level. So we got economies of scale. And that's how we got thermal scanners, thermometers, and you know, your oximeters, your sanitization kits, whether it's alcohol based, whether it's non-alcohol based, should we get our toilets fumigated? How do we operate? Then we got into fumigation. Please understand, if there is a COVID patient in your office, that entire floor gets, you know, codoned by BMC in good old days. Now the processes have changed over the last 6-7 months. So we had to get our fumigation equipment in order to make sure that we were completely prepared with sanitization, because life and livelihoods are two distinct factors, and we can't, you know, exclude each other. They are mutually inclusive. And in light of that, we brought in, then we decided that if there are going to be 50% of people, okay, so we did a roster for branches, so it was easier. When we came to central offices, please understand, employees like to be appraised. They are people with flesh, blood, and water. You know, we as corporate citizens of the corporate, we have to make sure that when their appraisal cycle comes up, they are evaluated for the right reason. So we created a crack team called the team which worked on the deciding a productivity metrics and a productivity monitoring process, because you can't have people work from home with no clear direction as to what are they supposed to deliver for. What are we monitoring them for? So there was complete chaos, right? Everybody said work from home, there was no timing, anybody could be called at any time. So actually at HR, one, we kept calling people. I got my HR bot alive, you know, which was a pending activity, which got alive. So we had an HR bot with all FAQs. You could use technology to reach us. The next big thing that happened in the bank was, you know, there is this webinar, right? Like the one you're doing right now. We are perennially listening to webinars of people who are independent of our organization. This has been the best period for me. You know, all the SME experts in the bank today do webinars as a done practice. So we got content which our HR team prepared, trained these people, and we started delivering content to our employees. The leadership who was working from home could give us those 2 hours on a regular basis to just talk to our employees. So you feel connected. The next thing that we did very, very well was our digital reward and recognition program. We had 7,500 employees dialing in along with their families. I think it was phenomenal what happened. And this actually went on live to being a reality. So from a metrics perspective, there is one challenge that still we need to overcome. So you have homogeneous jobs and you have heterogeneous jobs. Homogeneous jobs, which are monotonous in nature, can work from home and can have a productivity metrics, a productivity software which plays behind your main main system for you to register how many transactions, et cetera, you're doing. The real challenge will be for heterogeneous jobs. That's jobs like HR, legal, finance. We still have to get it right as to how are you going to actually measure the productivity of these people if they had to do 100% work from home. So in light of this, knowing that people like to be appraised, people like to be evaluated, very strongly, we have now run a roster based on social distancing. We have a 2D and a 3D model. I do 4D. So you can do 2D, 3D, 4D, 5D. You have 2 shifts which you can come in. So we have a shift which is from 9:30 to 4. And we have another shift which starts at 11 o'clock, goes up to 5:30. We have given all the work from home employees the ability to have 1 silent hour. that is between 1 to 2 p.m. we don't disturb our employees who are work from home. You have all the, you can disturb us, we don't disturb you, people who go to office. Those jobs which absolutely don't require us to come to work because we have a productivity software which is already ingrained in their laptops, even in their bring their own laptops. Those bunch of people, we've said 70% of them can work from home, only 30% needs to come in. But heterogeneous jobs, we've split it into 50-50, and that's how we continue to function. There are many learnings out of this. Now, what do we do on stress management? We've tied up, we are running this whole campaign in the bank called the Wellness Wheel. The Wellness Wheel is primarily touches various aspects of wellness. It's about Corona Warriors. We have a quick response team. We have a hospital tie-up, but we also have stress management. We've also guiding employees who work from home on what kind of chairs they need to sit on, the ergonomics, the anxiety, the counseling centers. We have tied up with a online company, which is a doctor online kind of arrangement, where you can call and fix appointments for doctors. So these are some, you know, of the things that we have done over the last 7 months, notwithstanding the fact that we have to continue to be legally savvy. We have to meet our quarter on quarter numbers. We have to meet our regulatory demands. It's a macroeconomic environment. So we have to look at the economics of the world along with being a banker is probably, you know, a realization that it's not an easy job anymore. So we have a regulatory environment. Then you're an essential service. You are as good as a doctor or a nurse. You have to get to work and you're not as appreciated as a doctor or a nurse. So, you know, what is the motivation that brings employees back to work? It's leadership that brings employees back to work. I don't work from home because my employees work from office. So I have to walk the talk if I believe this is the right thing to do for the company. So in sum and substance, it's better to go to work because you see people, you learn, maybe you develop herd immunity over a period of time, and work from home, you will have to bring this anxiety factor upfront. How are you going to manage their appraisals? How are you going to give them career options? I think we have a long way to go there. You know, so we have found employees quite happy coming back because we've done this in a phased manner. They're quite happy coming back. But yes, there are challenges. And, you know, talking to people, being on seminars, learning best practices, hopefully we get there.
Thanks for sharing all that. I think that's a lot of thought. You know, you've given us to mull over. So now I'm going to ask Jasmine, because yours is a clean energy company, but in your role, you also manage CSR and you have hundreds of villages under you. So can you please share a little bit about what y'all have done at the Suzlon Group? You're on mute, Jasmine.
As a renewable energy company, the wind turbines are in the remote rural villages. We also have a layer of site managers and site engineers who are there in the remote areas. Then there are these offices in the smaller cities and offices in the bigger cities. So our strategies had to be different for each. As far as the medical part is concerned, which was one of the most important things for us to keep everybody safe, early in March itself, we formed a COVID task force, which was a cross-functional team, which had representatives from HR, different business units, as well as the medical team. We initiated a 24-hour helpline. We have 8 doctors who were manning these helplines and responding to queries from each and every employee and their family member. It was a 24-hour helpline. Simultaneously, we were gathering information, also notifications, trying to interpret the guidelines being given by the Government of India, Ministry of Health, as well as the ICMR, because we had to be on top of it to be able to guide the employees on what to do and what not to do. One of the important things over here was the fear factor, especially in the initial period in March, April, when certain people had to go into the field and start off their operations, whereas the others were at home. So it was very important to ensure that there was confidence and all the safety aspects were being considered by those who were on ground. And so we started this campaign of COVID comrade calls, by which we identified around 200 volunteers who were trained and who would make calls every week to the employees and their family members. And it was wonderful because there have been instances where people said that, you know, I had just resigned and I'm in the notice period, but it's so wonderful to get a call from office or from from a volunteer asking about how I am in my home, how my family is doing. So that was a very well appreciated initiative. We made over 50,000 calls. There were more than 5,000 employees and their family members. There are instances when the family member would say, the employee would give the phone to the family member and say that, you know, please talk to my wife. Please explain to her that, you know, there's nothing to be worried about. So that whole thing brought in a little bit of cohesiveness, reduced the anxiety levels in the initial period. At the same time, we had to, like the previous speaker had said, about getting people back to work in a very strategic manner. And in this, the medical team as well as the HR did a wonderful job of mapping all the requirements and ensuring that the essential persons were able to come back and come back with confidence. Also, like some of the other speakers said about the insurance aspects, they were also taken care of. Most importantly here for us at CSR and Sustainability Division, we had to ensure that the NGO partners whom we work with, as well as the village development committees with whom we have been working so far, were not left behind. And therefore, we made calls to them, we explained, we provided them with extended the services that are available for the employees in terms of 24-hour helpline was extended to them, and they could contact us for any support. So in this manner, we were able to first bring confidence to all the different stakeholders and then slowly get back to work. Now, there is staggered work situation in the offices in the cities based on the government guidelines. But the site level where the wind turbines operate, they have been functioning from the beginning and they have not closed until now because they are part of the essential services.
Thank you. I mean, that's something to think about when, you know, some employees have to return back to work and some don't. And, you know, in the midst of a crisis a few months ago, it might have been extremely difficult to, you know, kind of absorb that. But y'all seem to have been managing that well, both at the bank as well as Suzlon and Bajaj Electricals. Now, Menas, you've been in transition during COVID-19. I can't even imagine, like, how do you join a new company? Of course, now, in, you know, after 7 months, you might be able to meet them personally. But I do know others who have switched jobs at the height of the lockdown, and they've started where you meet people for the first time over a digital device, and it feels awkward, but now it's the new normal. But can you share a little bit in your experience as the former head of HR, what were the things that you all did at the start of the lockdown, and how does it feel to now transition into a new role?
I think first and foremost, let me just clarify. I think I joined the new organization in October. So I experienced the full brunt of COVID and I think the learnings that we had as an organization. I think the amount of pride that I have as both an HR person, as an employee, to belong to a group like Godrej has been immense, because you realize in times of crisis and challenges how organization leaders truly behave. Because it's these rare moments where you see people completely without any facade at their truest, you're able to actually, they actually reveal their truest core. And I think it was humbling to be part of an organization like GoTeach. I think the few things that we did, and it was great to hear everyone touch upon some very interesting practices. I think the core of this entire crisis was for employees to feel heard and for them to feel more than just an employee of a company. And I think that involved and many people have talked about making calls, reaching out via bots. We did a combination of the two, both reaching out to employees one-on-one and actually using things like the employee bot to figure out what is going on and what they're facing, right? So if I talk three specific practices that I think really helped us. One, because we are a large company which manufactures products and manufactures key essential goods like soaps, hand washes, household insecticide repellents. It was important for our shop floor people and our sales people to get back into operations really, really quickly. And this was in the early days of April itself, so not something as late as now, which depending upon your nature of job is possible. So one of the first things that we actually had to learn, both as HR and as production, was how do you run a factory with less than full capacity? And how do you run a factory with social distancing norms, which are completely new? Because this is a contained environment. So you have to be really careful of thermal scanning, checking for people, your SOPs in place. If somebody is found to be COVID, please also be mindful that you have contract laborers who are coming in from various locations. So to be able to run an operation in a safe working environment or the new normal that we call was the biggest learning. And while we were doing this, you also realized that the family members of these people weren't also convinced. So we had to up our communication by either sending it via video or actually doing one-on-one conversations with the family on why we are going to take care of them when they are in the factory, right? I think this was a very, very important practice that we did. So we had videos floating around. We had what does a safe working environment in a factory look like? And we actually showed these real things to families and employees. I think second thing that we had to manage, and I think I was humbled by the fact that that leaders like Nisa Godrej, Sunil Kataria, all of these leaders were so very clear that safety is going to be paramount and safety is going to be first. We were one of the first companies who actually took out life insurance cover for our third party employees. I'm not talking employees who are on our payroll, but employees who are not on our payroll. And we actually took out life cover, we took out medical cover for these individuals, because the biggest question that was there on their heads was, what if I get COVID while I'm in the market and I'm not covered? So, you know, what are you going to do about me and my family? And the fact that we were able to do that really instilled that sense of confidence and the fact that we're looking out for you as a person versus just a resource, right, who's going to get us our business. I think that was the second important practice. I think third important practice was just staying connected. And I think leadership really stepped up here. And by that, what I mean is, earlier when I was mentioning that never let a crisis go to waste, I think all the efforts that CTOs or CHROs have been trying to do on location-free roles, on virtual working, on work from home, on flexible policies, on virtual training, right? All of that got done in one shot, right? This was a reality that one had to deal with. So all the mindset barriers that people had, I think there was no other way to work around it. So I think we really stepped up our leadership communication on touching base with employees on a regular basis, on just keeping them updated on what's happening with business, what's happening with our factories, what's happening with our new launches, because Godrej, with this was also in the entire space of sanitization. So we really upped the ante of new launches. We did launches in timelines that we've never done before, right? Because we rolled out sanitizers, surface disinfectant sprays, new products to be able to take care of given this whole pandemic. So I think keeping employees updated on what's happening, plus listening to them and figuring out what's happening with you really helped. So one of the things that we realized, and this was being talked of in media, but when you hear it from your employees, I think it was important, which is that there are no timelines anymore, right? There's no support system at home. This was not, and this continues to be not a normal work from home. where you have your maid, you have your support system, perhaps your mother-in-law is staying with you, somebody's there to take care of your family, food. You had women and men, hopefully men who were partaking in household responsibilities, doing all of this by themselves and still working, right? So this understanding and this realization, I think managers became more empathetic to the situation. So these practices of silent hour, please have these conversations with your team. So every manager had the conversations with their team of what are some, you know, work hours or work timings you want us to be mindful about. Because you had children joining schooling, virtual schooling that they'd never done. And for children who were really young, a parent needs to sit with them, right? They're not just going to figure it out all by themselves. So some of these new realities that I think our employees were experiencing, we became mindful about it. And there were work practices that were designed to be able to, you know, work around it. So I think, so in simple words, first ensure them that we're looking out for their safety. And that is a matter of insurance. We actually shipped seats, their chairs, because, you know, chairs in offices are much more ergonomic, more expensive, hence, you know, comfortable. We actually shipped some of these chairs to their homes, right? So just cognizance of the fact that, you know, people need to be taken care of. That's the first practice. Second, ongoing leadership communication, both to give business updates and to understand what's happening with them. And I think lastly, designing new work practices, both for our sales force and our manufacturing people, who, because we were in the essential goods, were expected to start operating right from the beginning of the lockdown.
Thanks, Menas. All of you have actually honed in on the communications part. And if you really see the countries that have handled COVID well, their leaders have kept their citizens constantly updated. And I'm reminded of Jacinda Ardern, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, who even did a Facebook Live in her pajamas, and that resonated with a lot of people. So I am going to ask our audience, if they have any questions for the panelists, please put it in the chat section. And if you want a particular panelist to answer, you may take their name as well. But we already have the first question from Dilip, who asks, can you share best practices on daily, weekly meetings and reporting? Who wants to take that? So whilst y'all think about that, maybe I want to ask Suman actually. So Suman, you know, I noticed on your Facebook page of Bajaj Electricals, y'all in April itself recognized that the gender inequality at home is skewed towards women picking up the majority of the house care and the domestic care work, which is unpaid work. So y'all encouraged everybody to share the workload. So can you share a little bit about that? Like, you know, how did y'all think of that? Because people weren't at that time even starting to talk about it. So a little bit of the background on that post.
During that time, March and April is when the lockdown had started, and people were actually going through difficult times. When I say people, it's employees, it's the family members, and also our consumers. So what we realized is that as an organization, as a brand, so we needed to be besides our people, our consumers. And when I say that, it means, like, you know, just to be empathetic to them, just to be genuine, and just to be there besides as a brand. You don't really have to sell your products. You don't have to really push your a certain set of products to them, trying to hard sell them. But instead of that, just be with them. And that's what was the need of the hour. And people wanted that. So we realized that, and that's how, like, you know, this concept of, you know, of this video came up, wherein we had a bunch of our senior employees, senior leadership employees, who actually were seen in this video to be doing some household chores, be it, like, you know, somebody cutting some vegetables, or maybe, like, you know, iron clothes, or even we had our chairman and our, like, you know, executive director on also on the video doing some household work. So what we wanted to show our consumers that we are in these difficult times, we are not trying to sell our products. We are not trying to, say that, buy this kind of set of products from us. But we are trying to be there as an assurance, be an empathetic, a brand for you who is genuine in their difficulties, difficult times. And try to understand and share the same problem, because we wanted to also tell them that what you are doing at home, we are also facing the same kind of situation. Our employees are also facing the same kind of situation. So that's how we got some of our real-time employees to shoot for this video, and then we posted that in our Facebook. And therein we said that it's like, work for home. It's not like work from home. It's like work for home. So the main folks are seen to be, working and doing, helping in the household work. So that's what basically the concept was, and that's how it originated.
I think that's great, because, if you can't see it, you won't be it. And normally we say it for women, but this is, if you don't see men picking up the fair share, you don't feel like you have to follow suit. So this was great, and it's I hope many more leaders do it. I know in many of my groups, the men on the groups have actually said that they've been pitching in a lot. Maybe they've never done it before, but COVID-19 is making everybody try out new things. So they are cooking and they are cleaning and helping with the children's education as well. So that's great. So Jasmine, do you want to pick up Dilip's question on can you share best practices?
About reporting?
Yes, on daily, weekly meetings or reporting.
I'm not sure what exactly, but basically it is about discipline and nothing in particular about COVID-19, but a daily practice of planning and writing on whatever you're doing and keeping your manager updated, I think is a good practice. I'm sorry, I don't have anything more to add.
So Elsa, let me try and come in if that helps. I think first and foremost, as you've realized with a lot of panelists and what they've shared, the expectation on performance and work hasn't come down during this time, right? It has been reoriented in the way it gets done, but the expectation has not come down. And obviously reporting meetings or weekly meetings are a critical part of staying on the course. Like, where do you need to come in? Where is help needed, etc. So I think one of the learnings that I have had, and I've shared this just basis the way I've managed my team and seen some stuff that I think has worked, is that keeping the video on is a basic expectation that I've communicated to my team, or at least when we're in meetings are important. Right, having that video, having that body language being communicated, your attention time span changes when you're on the video versus off the video. That I think in weekly meetings is like a must that we follow. Second, I've realized because you're in an environment where you're naturally at home, and because my team in GCPL majority was also women, it was very common for children to come in into the video, right? For children to be making some noises, or for them to take out 2 minutes to, answer their child's question. And that's considered to be absolutely okay and normal. So please allow some of their home lives to come in to work. Because at the end of the day, if you become really uptight about it, or, quizzical about, why has this person come on the video screen, I think the team would just be more and more uncomfortable. Third, expectations on what the updates needed to be on the meeting were the same that you had pre-COVID or post-COVID. Obviously, you were very mindful that if, there was somebody who was unwell, or, some team member was just off from a mood perspective because, they were just going through, I'm just getting frustrated, especially people who are used to a lot of social connect and social interaction. They're just frustrated staying at home morning to night. You were cognizant of that fact and you'd have a separate conversation with that individual, but performance expectations didn't change. So for virtual effectiveness, my learning has been video. Second, just allow some of their home lives to come in, and people who are more quiet than usual, please ask for their input and opinion, because virtual also makes that a bit more difficult, especially if you have 20 people on a call And only the ones who are going to be very opinionated or generally extroverted are going to state their point. People who are not are going to be silent. So please ask for that opinion and point of view explicitly. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah,
so
thanks,
Elsa, I'd like to add a few things.
Yeah, and maybe you can also answer Tasneem's question on, do you have a practice that regulates screen time and limits to a level that's not harmful to the person's physical and mental health?
I'll understand that question a little better reading it, but let me just tell you about the productivity. See, for branches, our productivity is like a normal day, because it's like employees come to work, you have a conversation, you do all of that. But when you look for central and zonal offices, our model is a little different. We have activated Microsoft Teams, we have Zoom, we have WebEx. So we have a normal virtual meeting in the morning by every business head. I'm not going to restrict myself to what HR does, because HR is a heterogeneous job. If you look at homogeneous jobs, they have clearly articulated the transactions that they need to do on an hourly basis. It's all programmed. We know exactly how many employees are going to, how many customers are going to hit the counter, how much of central clearing needs to be done. So I think the productivity matrices are pretty clear. It's a daily job to ensure that end of day happens. We use technology a lot. We have activated everything for every employee who manages teams. Individual performers might have a direct sales report. They continue to do this on a conference call with their team leaders, where the input goes into the MIS team and the MIS team, you know, tracks this. Now, their branches do it daily. Certain businesses do it weekly, especially recoveries, collections, etc., where we have to do it daily. And because the regulator keeps changing, the moratorium, there are also impacting variables. It's not like a vertical which we can run ourselves. So we look at the regulatory updates and we keep changing our matrices accordingly. As far as the HR team is concerned, we operate 50% from office and 50% from home. In the 2D, 3D, 4D, 5D model, all of us come based on social distancing. And while we do all the calls, we have a clearly articulated expectation. So if you look at trainings, we have to do 50 trainings in a particular period. If you're going to do 50 trainings in a particular period, we have calls in the morning where we track them. But this is not weekly and this is not daily. What we actually do is once in 45 days to just take an update on the outcomes. What we definitely do virtually is the communication updates on where people are leading projects. And that's how we map productivity of individuals based on what they want to deliver. What we do very well is every Saturday in the evening, we do what we call the Zoom party. So you can be yourself. And just like Maina's just articulated, that there are people who don't come up. So the next party, we make sure those four or five people also show us the soft side, because they are normally the ones who are very anxious. The ones who are extrovertish by nature are those who will talk their mind even in a Zoom call or in a Microsoft Teams call. So I think it's important to find out which are those elements that we've used differently, but we do based on business, whether it's daily, weekly, or I think that was Dilip's question, whether it's daily, weekly, or monthly. I don't think all our programs are daily, weekly, or monthly expected. Your second question, I need to read that question just to understand.
Since all communication now is based on the use of internet-based devices, be it smartphones or laptop computers, many of us end up clocking over 8 hours of screen time every workday. Do you have a practice that regulates the screen time and limits it to a level that's not harmful to a user's physical and mental health?
You want me to answer this?
If you can, very briefly.
Okay. So we, like I said, we do a 2D, 3D, 4D, 5D model. So we don't have anybody working 100% from home. So obviously, the people who are working 100% from home, we also have a silent hour. And in the early days, I think we went ballistic about having people on Saturdays, Sundays, etc. But right now, they also follow our office timings even at home. So it's not necessary that everybody is getting overtly exposed. We also encourage conference calls. We also encourage off video.
Okay.
And just like Mainas, I like people dressing up and coming on screen because I just don't like people being lax at home and thinking it's okay. But that's different. I mean, I like to see them on video. It's my personal want, not everybody's want.
Well, on that note, I think it's time to move to the breakout session. So I'm really thankful to all of you, Suman Ghosh, Mena Sheikh, Jasmine Gogia, and Shanta Valluri Gandhi for sharing all these wonderful practices. I've been like taking down notes furiously, a lot of good stuff out there. And now I want to hear from the audience. So my colleague Anusha is going to open up the breakout room. So just so that you know what a breakout room is, they are smaller groups where, you know, we have the chance to talk to each other. We'll have 15 minutes of breakout rooms. And you will find on your screen a little button where you have to join the breakout room. If you're on the phone, you might have to move one screen. Just click on it and you'll be taken there. So thank you everyone for joining us, our panelists. Appreciate that you took out the time from your busy schedule. So, and thanks for sharing all this wonderful information. I'm sure it's going to help us. And now, Anusha, may I request you to please take us to the breakout rooms.
Thanks, Elsa. So we leave the room now and we say goodbye to all of us.
Shanta, if you can and want to join the breakout room, you're most welcome. But if I know you might have something else to do, so yeah. I leave it up to you. So thank you.
So thanks, Elsa, for this opportunity.
Thank you, Elsa.
Thank you very much.
Really. Thank you, Elsa. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hi, Elsa. It's you and me here.